Hello, welcome back to Politicized. Today we're going to be speaking to Brian Rose, running for London Mayor. I've been waiting for this for a long time and I cannot wait to show you. Please stick around till the end. With Brian Rose, which I never thought I'd be saying. I've been following your campaign for a while now, and I'm really excited to actually get to meet you and speak to you. So you, just to let everybody know who doesn't, you're an American-born banker who moved to London in 2002, and after a time you founded London Real, which is like a kind of podcasting, kind of video, and also courses. I think it does a lot of different things, and now you're running for mayor. So thank you very much for giving up your time and coming on.
Hey, my pleasure. It's great to be here. I always like to see young broadcasters. When I started 10 years ago, nobody knew what a podcaster was in London, and very few people were on YouTube. And so 10 years later, I've had about 1,000 of these conversations. And so I like to see that people are doing it, especially younger people. So congrats on doing this.
Thank you.
So one thing I was wondering, I've been following your campaign for a little while too. You've said that the two other mayoral candidates, Sally Cannon and Sean Bailey, are both out of touch with the people of London. But given that Sally Cannon grew up in a council estate in London, his dad was a bus driver, and Sean Bailey was once homeless, whilst you're an American millionaire banker, do you not think those two relate better to working class Londoners than you do?
No, not at all, actually. I've lived here for 21 years. I've actually spent the last 4 months driving 4,000 miles through every single borough in London. And I've been out on the streets talking to people, finding out what their challenges are, what their problems are. I spent the last 6 months studying the problems of London. And I just created this 50-page manifesto.
Which problems all do of people the, highlight to you on the street? Which problems do people most
let me tell you right now. So this is a 50-page manifesto with all of the detailed solutions to the problems they highlighted on the streets. And there are actually four problems. Londoners care about the economy and their jobs. They care about housing, transport, and crime. That's what they came up and talked to me about. So I've been actually out there on the streets. You saw the current mayor of London went out on the streets, and he actually had to run and hide when some citizens came up to him and talked to him and asked him questions about a low traffic neighborhood. So I'm actually very much in touch with Londoners. Let me just say one of the things.
For the sake of truthful reporting,
he didn't run and hide from London Real for the last 10 years. Yes, for the last 10 years on London Real, I've had 1,000 people on my show and watched 500 million times. And so, you know, already 1.7 million Londoners knew who I was. So yeah, I'd say I'm actually much more in touch than either one of those two.
Piers, do you
want to
go?
Yes. So one of your main objectives for housing is to build 50,000 new homes by Christmas 2021. Quite an ambitious goal, I think we can agree. I know you have a site in place. Do you think you have the resources and like the funds to fund 50,000 new houses in the space of 9 months?
Yes. So I've been working with one of the top architects in London for the past 4 months, who's donated his resources of about 200 staff that have gone in and looked at the land that TfL owns. I don't know if you know this, but TfL owns 5,700 acres of land. It's the size of the borough of Camden. And much of this land we can put housing on right now. And the kind of housing you can put on is something called modular housing, where you actually design it, you custom make it. You can have one person up to six people there. It's built in a factory and then it's assembled within weeks. These are gorgeous homes. They've actually already been built on the Dyson campus right here in Britain. And they only cost about £100,000 each, and they can be erected quickly. And I've got a site in Hackney Wick. You've probably seen the drawing. And we've got sites throughout London. And I just want to make a point and show that it's actually not that difficult. The mayor of London promised 400,000 new homes in the past 5 years. He's built 12,000. It's always excuses. It's always Boris Johnson's fault. And I don't think it has to be. I come from 30 years in the business world where you have to be held accountable or literally you get eliminated. I see these politicians, they ask for bailouts, they raise your taxes. There's always an excuse. we can build these homes by Christmas. I mean,
you know, got an architect for an investment banker. Do you not find it somewhat hypocritical for an investment banker to talk about bailouts, given what happened in 2008 and what probably happened after this recession? Yeah.
So actually, the last 10 years, I've been a broadcaster. So just to get that right.
No, but in 2008, you were an investment banker, and now you're criticizing governments for bailouts, which you were a beneficiary of.
I was an interdealer broker. I worked for a company called ICAP PLC. So they're actually slightly different roles, if you actually want to go into the details. But when it comes to what the current mayor has done, as far as him not completing affordable homes, like, how is that okay for Londoners? How is that okay for the homeless population? How is it okay that he's able to do that and not mention it once when it comes to his reelection? There's so much hypocrisy. There's so much failure. Look at knife crime. Look at transport. TfL is going bankrupt. He has got no solutions. And so it frustrates me. That's the only reason I'm in this race.
On the issue of housing, what would you do to make sure that the housing built will be bought by, will be affordable for and bought by Londoners rather than bought up by rich foreign people, as is very, very common in London nowadays?
Yeah, well, it's affordable housing. So if you look at the units, you know, they go for about £100,000 each, which is incredible.
How will you make sure that what Londoners can buy them rather than people from abroad, which is what happens with a lot of new development in London?
Yeah, well, they're modular homes. So
no, but how will you make sure that what Londoners buy them?
If you let me finish. So they're modular homes. So if you look at them, they're not high-rise buildings that are going to be bought by outside Londoners. These are places that are built in the communities. These are affordable, reasonable homes that people of London can move right into. And just by the way, if you build 50,000 new homes, it eases prices for rents and mortgages for all Londoners, including that has potential for the homeless situation. Or we can elect more leaders that just talk about building homes. And you know, that's what we've had from the past two different mayors, both from the Labour and the Conservative. And that's what frustrates me. You have a two-party system, has a stranglehold on politics. They sign off on each other's failures. They give you the illusion of choice, but it's the same thing. It's business as usual. It's the same argument we see on the BBC. So I'm trying to freshen it up with some innovation, some new ideas. I mean, the policy we created in the last 6 months is, it's groundbreaking stuff. It really is. And I think people really realize that. We have a lot of support from people out there and people on the streets as well.
Yeah. So would these new houses, would they be part of a social housing program, or would it be ensured that they can be sold for comparatively cheap prices?
I want to give priority to key workers on this. I look at the nurses, the firefighters, the teachers. They have to have places in London. Otherwise, we're going to turn into one of these emerald cities. And that's not what gives London its greatness. That's not what it gives its culture. So we've got to support this, as well as our small businesses. That's why rebuilding London's economy is prime on my list. That's why I want to do this 31-day great celebration. That's why I'm trying to do as much business with local Londoners, including my tailor, John Kent. You know, he's in his late 70s. He's about to go out of business, and we're going to lose, you know, hundreds of years of British tailoring. What makes this city great? And I think the current mayor of London and the prime minister have no plan to get the economy kickstarted. And that's what I want to do. And that's why I want to abolish the congestion charge till the end of the year, drop business rates to zero, just to get London working again. 20 million people in London for the month of August, street fairs during the day, music festivals at night, showing the world that we're back, that we want to lead the world when it comes to recovery, showing off this indomitable spirit. I mean, I just can't wait to do this event. And London's great at events. I don't know if you remember the Olympics 2012. Maybe that was a little young. I don't know, but we really crushed it as an event. And I want to do the same thing again. And, you know, London's based on business. That's the reason we're all here. That's the reason the Romans came. It wasn't because of the view. It was because this is a place of commerce. And I think we need to remember that. And then on the back of that, all the greatness happens. So that's what I'm focusing on.
Yeah. I want to ask you, after doing a bit of research, when you said you wanted to be held accountable, so I'm going to do that. Section 2 of the 2006 Fraud Act reads, made false representations dishonestly knowing that representation was or might be untrue or misleading, with intent to make gain for himself or others to cause loss or to expose another with risk of loss. After your David Icke video was taken down on all major sites, you started a funding drive to create a new freedom of free speech
platform. Are you reading from an article, or what are you reading from?
I'm reading from my question.
Okay, gotcha, cool.
So free speech platform, a blockchain system, and a legal challenge that you said you would go to the European courts with. You raised over £1 million. I have to ask, where did that money go? Did any of this go into your mayoral campaign? And finally, I've seen accounts accuse you of breaking the Section 2 of 2006 Fraud Act, which I just read out. Do you think you've acted in accordance with these regulations?
So last year, we had a massive fight for freedom of speech. And so just to give you a little bit of context, I started London Real in 2011. And for 9 years, I broadcast live conversations from my studio with a variety of guests, a variety of controversial guests, from Rose McGowan, who started the Me Too movement, to Edward Snowden's attorney, to Muazzam Begg, who was illegally imprisoned in Guantanamo Bay, to John Cleese from Monty Python, who I had on recently, who was being censored on major platforms. And on April 6th of last year, I was broadcasting an episode on YouTube. It was the second largest live stream in the world, so clearly it wanted to be watched. And afterwards, it was deleted and banned. And something felt wrong when you have a right to free speech as a human. Something felt wrong that was being banned. So I fought back against YouTube. Well, it was really the basis of my entire business, by the way. And I fought back against them. And we decided we had to move on and keep broadcasting these conversations. So we created our own platform. And we ended up pulling off the largest live stream of a human conversation in history on the back of that. And I couldn't be more proud of the work that we've done with the Digital Freedom Platform. I couldn't be more proud of what we broadcast and how we fought back for freedom of speech. So yeah, it was an incredible moment. And so many people are happy that we did this. We have so much support for what we did. And we raised that money and we spent that money building this platform, doing the live streams. And again, incredibly proud of that work. And that's one of the reasons we have so much support on this campaign, because we walk the walk as well. We stand for freedoms, and we've shown that we've supported these freedoms in the past. And I think people really appreciate that.
How do you imagine that your platforming of David Icke, who is a Holocaust denier, and said the Holocaust was one made up, and also that Jews, some of them are lizards. How do you feel that the quite large Jewish population of London is going to take to you airing somebody who denied an attempt to exterminate their race?
Yeah, I don't really know if that quote is accurate or not. This is what I try to do on London. This is what I try to do on London Real. So what I try to do on, just 1 second, by the way. First of all, what I try to do on London Real is try to get people on the show that have a wide range of perspectives, including Eva Schloss, who actually survived Auschwitz as well. And we had a long conversation with her. Rose McGowan of the Me Too movement, et cetera, the list goes on. And I try to put people in that chair and allow them to express their point of view, because that's their human right. Now, I met people on the streets that say, I disagree with that guest. I don't like what he said. And I said, okay, but do they have the right to say it? And they said, of course. Or should the government not give you the right? Should they protect you from those ideas? And I think it's better to have these conversations in open as opposed to someplace on the dark web. And I'm really about freedoms. I'm also about freedom for democracy. So when I was recently stopped by police and banned from campaigning, something felt wrong about that, not giving you the right to choose your candidates. So we're all about freedom. And I'm very proud of what I did. And I don't agree with everything my guests have to say, by the way, but I think I do believe in their right to say it. And I will defend that right to the death. And that's very, very important.
Can I jump in here? So I've just got a question on freedom of speech, because you keep repeating this during your campaign. And you said like you were going to create this digital freedom platform, which people are still concerned about where their money went, because you said you'd tell them exactly where every penny went. And I feel you avoided my question a bit there on that.
No, not at all.
But carrying on with my question, the Digital Freedom Platform, in its terms of service, says it determined anything offensive, unlawful, threatening, defamatory, obscene, or otherwise objectionable. This is no different to the YouTube terms of service, the exact thing you plan to oppose. And you also delete every single comment that is negative towards you on your live streams, on your YouTube channel. If you don't stand for freedom of speech, what do you stand for?
So I don't know what the question was there. What was the question?
The question was, do you stand for freedom of speech since you delete comments that are negative?
We clearly stand for freedom of speech. I mean, that's why we created that platform. Otherwise, all you have is the choice of Google, Facebook, et cetera, which all of those platforms deplatform me as well. We were one of the few people that continued to put those conversations, and we published those conversations. And so I'm very proud of the work that we've done. And of course, we believe in freedom of speech. Now, I don't believe in hate speech or anything inciting violence or the overthrow of governments. We've always been that way. And that just makes common sense. But again, very proud of the work that we've done. And that's why we have so much support in London. People really believe in what we do.
Okay, so you're polling at 4%, Warren, so I don't know how much support that is in London.
Well, the polls are a 20th century instrument on a 21st century phenomena. You should know that. Okay. I mean, the social media says different, obviously.
Let's not get into polling
the odds makers say differently as well.
Can I just carry on with my question? So in the freedom of speech, you've deleted comments that are saying things against you, against some of your work, but yet you're happy to give a platform to somebody who denies the Holocaust and who pushes the Elders of Zion thing, which was used by the Nazis. It was used by the Nazis. What's what they're doing? What is the difference?
I can't confirm or deny that. I've over 1,000 guests over the last 10 years.
You had David Chipman.
They have a variety of points of view.
So just to check, you're denying that David Icke said this, or
no? They have a variety of points of view, and I respect their right to say it. And I think they should have the right to express that point of view, and people should have the right to have those conversations.
Be elected mayor of one of the most diverse cities in the world
to debate that as well, and to consider that
to say the Holocaust didn't happen.
And also the comments. You've deleted comments off your channel that are even vaguely against what you're doing.
We have a social media team that monitors that. Again, we don't believe in hate speech, and we don't believe in anything that incites violence. Actually, what I really like to talk about is knife crime, which actually affects all of us every single day. I mean, there's teenagers being stabbed in the streets every single week, and yet no one's talking about that solutions. No one's talking about putting police on the streets.
You were talking about freedom of speech, which is the one thing.
As my publicist said, I've actually got a commitment, as he said, 20 minutes. So we're just after the hour. So Howard's just giving me a shake here. So look, we can pick this up at another time. But I really appreciate the time, guys, and we can pick this up next time we talk. All right, thank you very much.
There we go. That is Brian Rose, the mayoral candidate who is avoiding scrutiny. I'm going to put up right now. I have the emails. This says 30 minutes. Right now. Here we go. Right now, the time, that's not what I want. The time, right now, 5:33. We started at 5:10. I can give you the emails for that. And he said 30 minutes. So Brian Rose, the mayoral candidate, is avoiding scrutiny. He cannot answer the question, and he's avoiding scrutiny. I don't think he answered well a single one of our questions there, and he left. He left the meeting because his press advisor, that's Howard Bowen, his press advisor said that he had to leave. Now, I'm sure he had a very valid reason to leave 10 minutes early, but he couldn't give us that. And it was funny that
he was very busy, right in the
part when we were scrutinizing him. He deletes comments off his YouTube channel. And if anybody would like any evidence of this, I'm happy to provide all of this. And David Icke has said anti-Semitic things, blatantly anti-Semitic. He's pushed
protocols of the Elders of Zion.
Which
is an idea that the Jews are scheming to control the world that was used by the Nazis and just generally by the far right.
I feel we should read our questions out because Brian Rose is not here to answer them. So let's read our questions out. All right. I'll go first with mine. You say there's been a lack of science-based decision making. The government have had a team of top scientists in the UK. What do you have to match that? Here we go. At the end of 2018, your company Longstem, which operates London Real, reported a loss of over 300,000. What do you say to those who claim the mayoral bid was just a way to boost your own brand and popularity? Finally,
I would love to have seen an answer to that.
Finally, can I get your reaction to these comments on London Real's trust pilot about you? Top class grifter and manipulator. Brian Rose is a con artist. Simply money grabbing. These quotes are echoed on ScamGuard, a second website, and they most of them reference two particular courses, the Big Business Accelerator course and the Digital Freedom Platform, which the money was not used incorrectly. No matter what Brian says, they were not all the million was used. And again, I can link some videos about that in the...
He wasn't going to talk about any of that stuff. I think the only thing he really wanted to talk about was his manifesto and any questions we had about that.
Yeah,
he didn't want us digging further. But anyway,
if I just finish my question.
Sorry.
Another comment I'd like to get a response on is former host of London Real on a podcast said who's Nick Gabriel says Brian Rose is literally empty, as well as calling you a narcissist. So there are my questions for Brian Rose, but unfortunately he's not here to answer them. Would any of you like to read out your questions that Brian Rose should have answered?
Well, the last question I have...
He's calling me. His media guy's calling me. One sec.
Oh, let's listen to this.
There we go. That's Howard Bowen, Brian Rose's media advisor, who had no answer for me when I asked him about the why it was 20 minutes instead of 30. I don't even think it was 20 minutes. I don't even think it was 20 minutes. Brian Rose left because he couldn't answer our questions. So should we carry on reading out our questions that Brian Rose is not here to answer?
Well, the last question I had for him, which I almost got in once he brought up policing, but then he rage quit before I could, was throughout this campaign, he's described the two competitors who actually have a chance of being mayor, Sadiq Khan and Sean Bailey, as being crooks and criminals. However, the only candidate who has had any trouble with the police recently is him. He was cautioned on the 21st of January 2021 for campaigning, despite the coronavirus lockdown. He's claiming he was arrested. He wasn't arrested, he was just cautioned. But while simultaneously condemning other competitors for being criminals, he is pretending to be a criminal. I was going to ask him what on earth was going on there, but yeah, he's no.
Piers.
My last question was much tamer in comparison. Just going back to his manifesto, because he claims that London is no longer a world-class capital city, but along with New York, it's ranked as the city that's most in tune with the global economy, according to the Globalization World Cities Research Network, which surely suggests the opposite at this point. I'm not really sure where he's getting out there. And if he loves London so much, then surely he will know that it's one of the most important cities in the world, at least economically.
I want to drop this video very quickly to tell you the Brian Rose coverage is not over. We will be releasing a mini documentary on Brian Rose where I've interviewed somebody who took his business accelerator course, which has been called a scam, and also we'll be bringing on UKIP mayoral candidate Peter Gammons. So before the video continues, just watch this short clip. I promise you're going to want to stay for this.
My main thing has been that I've been a Christian inspirational and motivational speaker all over the world, spoken at some of the largest events of history. Yeah, these are not wild claims. These are a combination of letters from people that have written. They're all handwritten letters from people claiming that they were healed in answer to prayer. These are medical forms.
There you go. So if you would like to vote for Brian Rose for mayor who avoids scrutiny, then the 6th of May, you can watch the local election coverage. And I'm sure Brian Rose will get at least 4% of the vote as he's polled at. Although, according to him, what was it? 21st century
mechanism in a 21st century world.
Do you want any more explanation? Because you're not getting it.
I mean, his media advisor said we spoke over him. He wasn't answering our question. Like, I asked him a question about free speech. He didn't even address anything I actually talked about in my question. When I asked him about the London Real scam, which I probably shouldn't, I should change that. The London Real donations and also the business accelerator course, which people have had a lot of troubles in the past. And people have managed to get their money back, right? From card companies. There must be something going on there, because card companies are not just going to be like, oh, here's your money back. Because they've got to prove there's a scam or something going on. So Brian Rose didn't answer my question on that. He hasn't answered any of my questions. So I think it's perfectly fair enough for us to interrupt him.
Because it's politicians, if you don't speak over them, they'll just keep speaking rubbish the whole time. Like, he tried it there. We were talking about something and he's like, I'm going to talk about knife crime.
I know.
Then he suddenly remembered that he had somewhere else to be, very conveniently.
Knife crime, even a politician.
Yeah, knife crime. I agree. Knife crime is a huge issue in London. It's an absolutely massive issue, and it's going to be one of the things that's run on this campaign. But if you're not going to answer interviewers' questions, instead you want to talk about something else, what does that say about you as a politician? Like, what does that say about you as a politician? To me, that says that you can't answer the question. If you want to talk about something you want, then go on your podcast with 2 million subscribers that only gets 1,000 views. And please go on and please talk about knife crime like you already do. You have a platform and we're asking you questions. We're holding you to account. We're not here to give you a free platform to say whatever you like about your manifesto. We're here to question you and to talk about issues that young people and Londoners actually want to know about their mayoral like candidates. And I think taking £1 million off people and not knowing where that money's gone is a perfectly valid question to ask.
Yeah.
There you go. Brian Rose.
Brian Rose, everybody.
I must say I'm extremely disappointed. I was very much looking forward to getting good, meaningful answers from Brian, but maybe as expected, we instead got how great his podcast company was and how much he wants to talk about knife crime and his manifesto. That was so unsurprising. I've written it here on my notes. I can actually read you out what I've got in my notes.
Yeah, I saw it.
Here we go. From my research, I've also found out issues of funding and faking, etc., are quite touchy for Mr. Rose. So let's start off with questions of policy and eventually bring him to hard questions, and we might get a storm off. And then we've seen. And we did. I literally can't believe it. I can. It's really disappointing as well. Like, as young people, it's very disappointing to see a mayor, like, walking off because he can't answer questions. I mean, he's asking...
Especially when he attacks Sadiq Khan, so that Sadiq Khan ran away from citizens asking questions, and then he does that.
He complained about Sadiq Khan not actually coming to debate him. He came on to debate three under, like, what, 20, 21, something like that, under 20s, under 21s, and he wouldn't even stay for the full duration he was meant to. I mean, come on. If you wanted to debate Sadiq Khan, you should be able to debate a few young people.
Yeah.
There you go. Thank you, everybody, for watching this episode. Thank you to Tom. Go follow him on Instagram. A Few Things Wrong. He posts some great left-wing content. Obviously, subscribe. We are going to be having lots more coverage of the local elections and more. Thank you to Piers as well, of course. Thank you very much. And... I would say thank you to Brian if he was here to actually receive that thanks, but I did say thank you to Howard Bowen, who is his media person, so hopefully he receives that message.
There's some consolation.
This video, please consider subscribing and sharing this with somebody you think who might be interested in this. Remember, more Brian Rose coverage with the documentary. We'll also be talking to Peter Gammons, who is the UKIP candidate for mayor, as well as us going through the mayoral campaigns. And we're going to be talking about the Tory slander allegations. There's so much coming up in the next few days, so please do subscribe.